Hey guys, this is David here. So we're back at it again, but today with an unboxing. So as you know, a big part of the MBA is the academics. All that studying, crunching those models. Most people choose between Apple versus Windows. I'm a big Windows guy, so today we're gonna be unboxing the Lenovo X1 Carbon, which in my opinion is the best Windows laptop. Later on, I'll talk a bit about how I chose this laptop. So we're gonna get started with opening it up. So we got this seal here that I'm just gonna cut. Seems like it's pretty simple to open. So we got some foam. Ooh, this looks really nice. It's so slim, look at that. Also in the box, we have a charger. Opening this up. So we're opening up the box, which is actually a bit challenging because there's some air trapped in it. Let's see how this opens. Ah, there we go. The laptop is just right on top with a little nice tab to pull, just to pick it up. Peel it open this way. Ooh, and it is so light. Rather than read off a list of specs, I thought I actually spent a week using the Lenovo X1 Carbon before I gave my thoughts on what you should look for and how to choose a laptop for your MBA. So full disclosure, I actually have a desktop with two monitors that I plan on using as my main workstation. So for me, the laptop was really to take with me to school for meetings and presentations, stuff that I can't do when I'm away from my desk. So the first thing I want to talk about and get out of the way are the tech specs. This includes things like the CPU, the RAM, the hard drive, and the graphics card. Rather than bore you with the details of my X1 Carbon specs, I'll leave that in the details below. But I do want to touch briefly upon each of these four components. For CPUs, my general advice has always been that if you don't know the difference between one CPU versus another, then chances are it doesn't really matter to you. Especially when you're choosing between business brands like Lenovo, Apple, or even Dell. These are brands that have chosen an optimal small handful of CPUs for their laptops, so you can't go wrong. This becomes an issue when you go into other brands like HP and Acer, where there's a lot more variety in the different CPUs that they have in their laptop, so you'll have to pay a bit more attention. For RAM, I found that the sweet spot is between 8 and 16 gigs. Now, you don't have to worry about the different speeds like DDR3, DDR4, I can assure you it does not stand for Dance Dance Revolution. So just focus on whether you're choosing between 8 and 16 gigs. For your typical MBA use, like Excel, web browsing, 8 gigs is more than enough. Where 16 gigs come into the picture is if you have hobbies like video editing or Photoshop. For hard drives, 256 gigs is usually enough, because most people are saving their things on the cloud, like OneDrive or Google Drive. But if you have a lot of pictures or videos that you'd like to store, you can consider options like 512 gigs or even 1 terabyte of storage. The last thing that I want to briefly touch upon are graphics cards. For these business laptops like Lenovo, Apple, and Dell, they come with what's called an integrated graphics card. But for the gamers out there, you'll want to look for laptops with a dedicated graphics card. That's what's gonna provide you with the horsepower necessary to run your games. When choosing a screen for your laptop, there's actually a lot of factors you can look into to figure out which screen makes the most sense for you. First and foremost, there's the screen size, but there's also resolution, whether the screen is matte or glossy, the color quality of the screen, the brightness, the refresh rate, and even whether it's a touchscreen or not. When it comes to screen size, the Lenovo X1 Carbon has a 14-inch screen.
And that comes in the middle of the pack as screen sizes range from 12 to 17 inches. The obvious trade-off here is that when you get a larger laptop screen, you can see more, but it also means that the laptop is gonna be much bigger, and that lowers its portability. This can be partly mitigated by the bezel size. So this is the border that surrounds the screen. As you can see, the Lenovo X1 Carbon has very thin bezels as compared to, for example, the MacBook Air. What this means is that for any given screen size, the smaller the bezel, the smaller the laptop footprint. And as you can see here, even though the Lenovo X1 Carbon with its 14-inch screen has a larger screen size than the 13.3-inch screen of the MacBook Air, its total footprint is actually smaller than the MacBook Air. Next is the screen resolution. The sweet spot that I found is the 1920 by 1080 resolution. The trade-off here is that the higher resolution your screen, the more vivid the picture quality. But because your laptop is powering more pixels, it's going to significantly shorten your battery life. With that being said, for a laptop with a screen that's even 17 inches, it's going to be very difficult for you to tell the picture quality between a 1920 and a 4K screen. What that means is that unless you're staring at your screen right in front of your face, chances are you won't even be able to tell a difference. So there's no point in going for a higher resolution screen. So the next two factors I want to talk about are kind of interrelated, and that's whether the screen is matte or glossy and whether it has touchscreen capabilities or not. So the advantage of a matte screen is that it doesn't reflect as much light. So if you're like working outside a lot, a matte screen is something that might appeal to you. Whereas a glossy screen will reflect the sunlight and make it very difficult to see. Now, when it comes to touchscreen capabilities, most laptops that have touchscreens actually have a glossy screen. So if you wanted that capability, then you might have to sacrifice the advantage of a matte screen. Personally, I didn't really care for a touchscreen as it costed $200 to $300 more and it wasn't that much value add for me. The last thing I want to touch upon when it comes to screens is the refresh rate. And this is going to be most important for the gamers out there. For the rest of us, 60 Hz is more than enough. But when you're talking about fast-paced action games like shooters, you want to invest in a laptop screen that has at least 120 or even 144 Hz. This is going to make a major difference in your gameplay, and you'll see that it's a lot more smoother when compared to a 60 Hz screen. Next, I want to talk about the keyboard layout. Unlike desktop keyboards, laptop keyboards have a non-standardized layout. So each manufacturer has their own unique design. What this means is that it's really important to consider and find a layout that is comfortable for you to use. So I wanted to walk through some of the features and factors that you may want to consider when choosing the right layout for you. Firstly, I'm an Excel power user, and I use the page up and page down keys a lot. So it was important for me to find a layout that had easy access to these two keys. And Lenovo and Dell are the two manufacturers that I know that actually has this unique design where they put the page up and page down keys right beside the arrow keys. Next, you have the control and the function key. Most laptops have their control key in the bottom left corner, and that'll help a lot of users use common commands like control C to copy and control V to paste. But you'll notice that the Lenovo actually has the function key in the bottom left corner. And this can be annoying if you're used to just reaching blindly for that control key. But this is actually not a big issue because Lenovo allows you to swap the roles of the function and the control key. Next, I want to talk about some of the irregular shapes and sizes of common keys, like the Enter key, the Shift key, and the Backspace key. Some of the designs will have very short backspaces, or very short shift keys, or even tall enter keys. This becomes a personal preference as to what size you're used to and what size you want for those keys. An issue that has plagued the Mac world has been ports. Remember the MacBook with its single USB-C port? I think it's safe to say that the more ports, the better. But the Lenovo X1 Carbon on its left-hand side has two USB-C ports, a USB-A port, an HDMI, as well as a headphone jack. Now, despite the industry pushing for USB-C as the standard, I would advise you to choose laptops with more USB-A ports, as most devices still use this connection. Now I want to spend a bit of time talking about the HDMI port as well. This is what outputs to your monitors as well as screens for your presentations. And the two main options are HDMI and DisplayPort. Now I would recommend that if you had to choose between the two, you choose the HDMI, because I found that most schools and offices still have their screens using this technology. Now on the right-hand side of the Lenovo X1 Carbon, you have another USB-A port as well as the power button. The one annoying thing that I'll point out about the Lenovo X1 Carbon is when it comes to charging. Because the laptop only has USB-C ports on its left side and its charger needs a USB-C port, that means I can only charge it from its left side. This becomes kind of annoying when the power outlet is on the right side and you'll have to loop the wire all the way around. Next, I want to talk about the sound systems on these laptops. So all laptops have a combination of upwards, sideways, and downwards facing speakers. The Lenovo X1 Carbon actually has two upward facing speakers, but most of its sound comes downward. In general, you want a laptop with upward facing speakers, as that directs sound straight to your ears. Personally, I like taking my laptop to bed or to my couch to watch Netflix, and I was concerned that just by having downward facing speakers, when I put it on my blanket, it might muffle the sound. But luckily, the Lenovo X1 Carbon doesn't really have that issue, despite the fact that most of its sound comes from its downward facing speakers. So I can't talk about which laptop to choose without delving into battery life and portability. When it comes to battery life, don't just look at the battery size, because that can result in varying battery life depending on the specs of your laptop. Typically, manufacturers will post what they expect the battery life to be on their website, but these numbers are often created under artificial conditions, such as lowest brightness settings or having no programs running. So I'd advise you to read some reviews on your laptop, watch some YouTube videos, and try to estimate what that battery life would be under use conditions that are similar to yours. This has a direct impact on portability, because the larger the battery, the heavier the laptop is, and therefore the less portable. Now, if you're a heavy user that is expecting to use the laptop for longer than your estimated battery life, then you'll also want to consider the weight of the power brick, because you'll have to carry this around. In fact, you might actually want to purchase a laptop that has a very small battery, but also a very small power brick, because you're gonna have to carry both around anyways. The last thing that I wanna talk about is the webcam. When it comes to laptop webcams, the quality difference between the best and the worst is not that large. So what's more important is the positioning of the webcam. Some laptops have it near the bottom, which means that your viewers will have a great view of your nostril, so I'd recommend looking for webcams that are positioned at the top. What's really cool about the Lenovo webcam is that it has this privacy shutter. So for those of you who are afraid of the government spying on you, this might be something you want to look for.
So as a recap, in terms of choosing a laptop, think about what matters to you. Is it portability? Is it battery life? Really focus on the 2 to 3 things that matter to you and be prepared to compromise on some of the other factors.